All right, let's talk some Tua. Tua continuing to play well. He's really played well down the stretch, and that's nice to see if you're a Dolphins fan. As hey, you know, there's even hope of at 5-7, maybe they can make the playoffs. Maybe they're not dead yet. So we'll see how that goes. And with Tua, I mean, even if this ends up being a lost season and you don't win another game, if you have a franchise quarterback, that's not a lost season. That's actually a pretty good one. So let's, you know, get into the film study and talk about what Tua has been doing so well and what he did so well this week. All right, so let's start things off with this play. What's going to happen here is it's a cover two zone. And what you're doing is Jalen Waddle just going to be running a route underneath. It's worth mentioning on a third down and 11, it's a little bit different than a traditional cover two zone. You're going to play a lot more soft. You're going to play off more if you're a defense because, you know, give up 8 yards, it's a good play, right? Or typically in cover two zone, that's not a good play. So they're going to let Waddle kind of be free underneath a little bit and watch how this works. So real quick, Waddle's going to get open, and you could argue it's for several different reasons. It's because the defense is kind of letting him get open underneath a little bit. You could argue Waddle's doing a great job of cutting and running this route. I think that's all fair. This is a throw that you have to make as an NFL quarterback. Just getting it to him, hitting him, you have to make this throw. The added value that Tua is going to have on this play is not hitting Jalen Waddle. It's hitting Jalen Waddle in a position where he can move and pick up at least the first down on this play. He has to hit Waddle in stride to make this work. That's where things get a lot more difficult, because typically you see this and say, yeah, wide open, not a difficult throw. But when you think about where he has to actually hit him, it becomes a lot more of a tight window, even though there's no defenders in the area, which is why I find it kind of a fascinating play. Tua has an absolute bullseye on that. I mean, if you know, if he was throwing it at a dartboard, he would have hit the bullseye. The nose of the football would have hit the bullseye. That's exactly what he was trying to do there. And great job by Waddle, too. Waddle had a great game. We'll get more into that, which is exciting to see, because Jalen Waddle is an exciting player, and it's cool to see him do well. But just a fantastic throw from Tua on that play. To me, that is an above replacement level play. A replacement level quarterback makes the throw, but you don't get the first down. And also some stuff like this where I like this play. It's going to be, the way it works is Tua is going to roll out towards the bottom of the screen. That's why you see all the routes are kind of going in that direction. Tua fakes a play action to his right, and then he rolls out. And the way you're doing this as well, focus on the tight end for a second who's going to be blocking the edge rusher. We've seen teams kind of start doing this more frequently. It used to be you just leave the edge rusher unblocked. He crashes in to try and stop the run, and the quarterback runs behind him. But the issue with doing that is now the NFL teams are kind of more expecting these types of rollouts. They can game plan around it, and they don't get fooled as much. So now what you've seen teams do more frequently is you'll have a tight end block him, or at least in this case, you know, start off blocking him. He will eventually run a route, though, but that's not what Tua is looking towards. Typically, Tua, you make your read kind of closest to yourself to furthest down the field. That's how you typically do this. However, when Tua takes the snap, you're going to see that he doesn't like any of these reads. And he's already looked at all three guys down the field. He doesn't like any of them. So this is kind of, I think, a really good play, because he's going through his progressions. He's currently on his third read, and that isn't open, so he's going to get to his fourth read on this play. Look, he does flip it to a tight end who's going to then pick up some yards, so that's only like a 5 yard gain. But the reality is, a bad quarterback doesn't gain any yards on that play, and now it's third down and 9 instead of third down and 4. So that's a pretty significant difference. So this is the value of a Tua quarterback. We also have something like this, which is kind of an odd concept, where I'm not exactly sure why to do it this way. I almost feel like you should have the receiver run the deeper route, have the tight end run a curl route, because watch what happens. Tua takes the snap, and you're going to see right here that when Tua wants to make this throw, he kind of has to get it past his own teammate to make it happen. So kind of a bit odd why they were so close. If you did it the other way, where the receiver was running the other route, he would have been, you know, gone by that point. Bit interesting there, but Tua is still going to time this one perfectly. As you see, Tua does still make a very accurate throw, and he gets it there the second he does. Even though it was a bit odd, he still found a way to make it work, and that's what you want to see happen. Not every play is going to work out perfectly and cleanly the way you expected it to on paper. You expect the quarterback to still make the throw. That's what Tua did there. And you also have some stuff like this where it's going to just be, it's a pretty simple play. It's just a zone buster to beat the zone coverage. But the idea is you're getting the ball to Jalen Waddle on this play. And this is kind of the whole logic of why they drafted Jalen Waddle instead of Penei Sewell was because their thought is, hey, we have a quarterback who, what's his skill set? His skill set is he gets rid of the ball quickly. He can be accurate at this over-the-middle stuff, at this underneath stuff. Let's get a receiver who will gain separation and get open and then gain a lot of yards after the catch. Let's pair these two traits with each other to maximize their value, which makes some sense. And so look, Tua's going to run a play action. It's a schemed open play. This isn't really that difficult of a throw for him to make again. But like I said last time, you're putting it in kind of the right spot for where Waddle can make the catch and continue to run. I pause it here so you see how open Waddle gets. So that's the clear bright spot of this play for sure. It's just where he's putting it. This one not as difficult as the last one I showed you, but still not the easiest play. And it's also a great Jalen Waddle play because watch how Waddle is able to then just, you know, he's able to accelerate and he's just faster than everyone else on the field. So he can pick up a ton of yards on this play. So cool to see kind of the vision that the Dolphins had when they drafted Waddle really finally come into fruition here. You know, even if it did take a little bit longer to see it kind of get its maximum value, now that we're seeing it, it's a lot of fun. If we want to talk negatives, this is one that it's a negative. It's not a huge one. This is kind of the only real negative I saw on this play. Some people are on this game. I mean, there wasn't many. Really, Tua was consistently good in this game. I mean, he barely incompleted any passes. He got sacked twice. Like, almost everything worked for the Dolphins offense in this one. But just to set the stage, it's going to be a third down and five. So you're trying to get the first down, but you don't want to take a sack. You're on the outside of field goal range. That's what you want to have happen. And this is kind of, actually, this is going to be a bit of an example of how secondary can cause sacks. Look, Tua looks at his first read, doesn't like it, and kind of holds onto the ball for a bit too long and doesn't really secure it. That's tough, right? A lot of people are just going to say, how can you even put any blame onto him? That is clearly on the offensive line and nothing else. I don't know if I fully agree. The contact happened at just shy of 3 seconds into the play, so there had to have been a little bit of a warning for Tua. Like, okay, this is going to happen, especially when you're like, hey, you play for the Dolphins. Like, your offensive line isn't good. This stuff does happen. At least secure the football. The sack itself isn't that big of a deal. But like I said, I'm nitpicking. There wasn't many negatives whatsoever. So this is I always try to find both. There really wasn't much negatives to find. Really good game from Tua, I think. So yeah, I mean, listen, a very fascinating situation with Tua. I kind of do wonder, it's like, you know, the intrigue with Tua and kind of why you almost have to give him a third year unless we see more, unless he, like, you know, completely sucks for the rest of the season, is simply because how good is Tua if you get a better supporting cast around him? We kind of always felt like Tua is the kind of guy where if he has a great supporting cast, he can be really good. And currently he hasn't had a great supporting cast, although the receivers have, you know, been solid, been kind of sporadic, I would say, whereas the offensive line has just been horrible. You get him a good offensive line, how much better is he? I think he could be a lot better, but maybe he's not. And that's where the intrigue comes in. And that's why it's so hard to develop a quarterback, because typically when you get a good quarterback, it's because you're not very good. So you have to add more talent as well. But, you know, at least a very good start for Tua so far, and you know, good hope. There's a lot of hope here for Tua going into, you know, the end of year two. That's what I think. What do you guys think? Let me know in the comments below. Always love hearing from you. And of course, as always, thanks for watching.